This is the Bookwaves Artwaves Hour. Interviews with writers on KPFA's nationally syndicated Bookwaves program, along with interviews about film and theater and archive book interviews that stretch back four decades. I'm your host, Richard Wolinsky. Today's program opens with a new interview with Pulitzer Prize-winning novelist Jane Smiley, discussing her latest novel, A Dangerous Business. That's followed by an interview recorded in 1990 with the great English novelist Faye Weldon, who died at the age of 91 on January 4th, 2023. The show concludes with a review of Clydes by Lynn Nottage. It's at Berkeley Rep's Pete's Theater through February 26th. An updated list of links to bookstore event calendars and live theater websites can be found on the kpfa.org webpage for today's program. Now on to the first interview of the Bookwaves Artwaves Hour. My guest is Jane Smiley, who has written a new novel, A Dangerous Business. This is the, I counted them, 18th novel. There are also five nonfiction books. There are eight young adult books. And before we go into discussing this, what about short fiction? Do you write any short fiction?
I haven't written that since I was younger, since I was in school. The only short piece I've written, which was about, five or six years ago, was a Shakespeare thing for the Folio Library. And it was about Marguerite of Navarre giving Desdemona some advice.
Do you just not like that particular kind of writing? Or it's just that you're more involved with novels?
I think short fiction is more about giving a bit of a surprise. And I like things to develop more slowly, and I like to think about them in more detail than that. So when I look back on my short pieces from, 30, 35 years ago, I don't really understand how I did it.
Well, let's talk about your new novel, A Dangerous Business. Last time I talked to you was about perestroika in Paris. Mm-hmm. And at that point, you said either you were completing it or even might have finished Dangerous Business at the time. But let's go back. After you finished perestroika in Paris and we were coming out of the pandemic, what brought you to write a novel about 1850s Monterey? I mean, you're there, but what prompted you to go, hey, this is what my next novel is going to be?
Well, some years ago, maybe 10 years ago, I thought I should do a Joyce Carol Oates sort of thing and do some murder mysteries set in California under an assumed name, under a pen name. And I thought, okay, I'll set one in each county in California. And then I looked and saw that there were 58 counties. I said, uh-oh, I don't think I can do that. But part of the idea was that I could do some historic murder mysteries. And the first one would be in Monterey County, because Monterey was the first capital. Didn't last long, but it was the first capital. So then I started walking around Monterey and looking at all the buildings, which are in great shape, and just being in the landscape and the town and the landscape and the town, looking at the missions, sort of thinking about the history, I thought, oh, this will be fun to do, even if I don't do 57 more.
And then it was in the back of your mind when you were writing other books.
Well, that's always true for me. I'm always switching back and forth between one project and another, because I think it's a good way to sort of, what's the word I'm looking for, kind of get your mind moving, to stop obsessing about the one that you're doing and to think about something else.
So you were actually writing A Dangerous Business while you were writing Perestroika?
Well, not on the same days, but, I do, say, a draft of Perestroika. And then when that draft was finished or had been sent to the publisher or something, then I would work on A Dangerous Business, because I don't like to have any time going by where I'm not working on something.
So when you were busy finishing up on Perestroika and working on a Dangerous Business, that was still during, it wasn't a shutdown, it had already kind of faded away a little bit, but you were pretty much stuck unless you wanted to take your chances in Monterey, right?
Yeah, but there's nothing wrong with being stuck in Monterey. At least I wasn't stuck inside the house, so I could go outside, and it was a great opportunity to explore the town and the streets, but also the trails and the paths around town that I had never walked on before. And that was really fun.
Did you have a map of 1850s Monterey to guide you?
Yes, there were maps. It wasn't exactly a map, but there were pictures. The streets haven't really changed their names. They've been paved because they were very muddy in those days. But a lot of the streets are essentially where they were. And a lot of the buildings that are on those streets are from that period, as early as, say, the 1840s, and then subsequent to that. So you could look at, or I could look at the buildings and sort of sense what it felt like to be in the location. And also, I could be glad that the streets were paved.
I would think, certainly in the past few weeks. Monterey, was it heavily affected by the earthquake of 1906, or not so much so that a lot of older buildings still exist?
I do not think that it was very heavily affected. When we bought the house that I live in Carmel Valley, part of the deed, I guess it's called, said earthquake-free zone. So there are a lot of parts around Monterey and in Monterey that aren't as mobile as up in, around San Francisco.
Jane Smiley, you decide to write a novel. It's going to be set in Monterey. You pick the 1850s, and now you've got to create a plot and characters. So what was the process of coming to the character of Eliza, and what was the process of figuring out the murder, and then on some level, kind of putting it aside to really delve into what it was like to live in Monterey in the early 1850s?
The first thing, thinking about what it was like to live in Monterey in the 1850s, that was my initial idea. That was always in the background. Now, I knew that there were a lot of migrants from the East and the Middle West. I did know that there was a brothel, and I wanted the main character to be a woman, and I wanted her to be able to support herself in Monterey, which would have been very difficult in the 1850s. And so I decided to blend those ideas and give her a way to earn a living and live an independent life.
You figured that she would, after becoming a widow, the best way to earn a living would be to become a prostitute.
Well, it might be the only way.
Really?
She might have gotten work helping, you know, as a servant or maybe as a nanny, though she has no idea about how to raise children or anything like that. And she doesn't know at the beginning, right after her husband has died. The only thing she knows is that she does not want to go back to Kalamazoo where her family is. And she has a little bit of money, but she doesn't know what else to do. And then this kindly woman comes up to her and says, "Why don't you come and see me?" And she goes there and realizes it's a brothel. But the woman is kinder to her than anybody else she's known. And her husband has been very sexually demanding of her. And so she feels, they've been married for about 2 years, and so she feels that this is something that possibly she could do.
And on top of that, it was kind of an arranged, not kind of, it was an arranged marriage. Mm-hmm. So she didn't have too much choice in whether she liked or disliked her husband, and apparently she did not like him.
No, I think he was quite deceptive. I think he thought that she was going to be a good helping hand for him. And he also, wanted to get to the gold rush. And I think he told the parents, or he let the parents think, that he was their religion and he had plenty of money. I did not delve too much into his motives for why he married her, but she's a nice-looking 18-year-old girl. He probably thinks he can push her around. And she's a good, healthy girl to push around.
What kind of research did you do? Were you able to do much research into life in the brothels? In other words, does Mrs. Parks come out of your imagination or out of your research?
She comes out of my imagination. But I knew there was at least one and probably more brothels in Monterey in that period because they were everywhere. You know, that was a way that That was the only way that men got satisfaction in some cases. And when I was finished with the manuscript, I gave it to a local historian, and he said, yeah, there were.
What about the one lesbian brothel? And saying lesbian is kind of not really the point, because women went there not necessarily because they were attracted to women, but because this was their place to get away and just be held.
Yeah, and taken care of and be treated kindly. The historian said that he didn't know of a specific brothel like that, but he said that it was plausible. So I took that as a yes, because I really, 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 really wanted Jean in this book.
Because?
Just because she's interesting.
How did she come to you? Did it just say, hey, there's got to be a woman who is different from the others?
Yes. I mean, Eliza, when her husband dies, she's not even 21 when her husband dies. She's lived a very circumscribed life, and she doesn't have, it's not that she's not smart and curious, but she has no experience that might lead her to understand what's going on. But she also needs a friend. Mrs. Parks does not want the girls who work for her to be very visible or to talk about what they do or to gossip with one another. So Eliza needs a friend. And Jean is the person who happens to come around and be her friend. And Eliza's instantly drawn to her because she senses that Jean is brave and athletic and funny. And Eliza likes that.
She definitely takes over the book in her own way. She can't help it.
Well, that's what we learned from Sherlock, you know?
Right.
That's what we learned from Sherlock Holmes. Watson gets to observe everything and Sherlock gets to be the main character.
In this case, it's less Sherlock Holmes than Edgar Allan Poe.
Yeah, that's true.
Did you draw on, it's been so long since I've read Poe, did you draw on any of Poe for the plot of the murder part?
No, only for the sense that Eliza and Jean have of how in the world to go about this, because nobody else is going to.
And so they take Lupin as their guide, in a way.
Yeah.
They are very well read in the sense that any book that comes to them, they're reading. Was that an actual factor in Monterey that people were clamoring for books to that degree?
Well, I think that there were books around, and it varied from person to person, but the books were expensive. So you had to borrow them or, you know, get a hold of them in some way. But definitely books were around.
Birth control, you describe that, and I assume that comes out of your research.
Yeah.
Where did you find about birth control? Was that part of the research into the brothel?
Yes. I mean, I think most women are interested in the history of birth control. I had never heard of a pessary before, but then I discovered what it was and that it was common in those days. So there were various things. And then if the young woman got pregnant, there were various things she could do then too. So I did whatever research I could do. and tried my best to put it in there.
And clothing and food, what they ate in that cafe and what she wore, was that separate research as well?
Well, mostly the clothing was about it, what was likely for her to wear around here, what people were wearing in that period. A lot of the clothing that she wears has been handmade, say, by a relative. The most difficult issue was the issue of shoes, boots, how you got around in the mud, how much they cost, who made them. I think that was probably the biggest issue.
You're listening to an interview with Jane Smiley, whose latest novel is A Dangerous Business. I'm Richard Wolinsky on the Bookwaves Artwaves Hour. When you were writing the book, did you come across any facts that you had no idea about that just kind of fit perfectly into the book?
One of the most interesting things about the research was reading about the way that the Hispanic settlers and the English settlers or the American settlers, the way that they got along. And in Monterey, around Monterey and Carmel, they got along pretty well. The other interesting thing was finding out about who brought the money and bought big pieces of property, what kind of property they got, what they did with the property, how each of the local towns developed. And so the peninsula has 5 or 6 towns, and each of them developed separately from one another. And each of them is, in some sense, a different landscape and a different climate. One of the most interesting facts that I hadn't known before was that they thought that Monterey was going to be a great big harbor. But then they discovered when it was settled that the orientation of the bay meant that the winds were too uneven or, you know, too variable. And so sometimes the ships could get in and sometimes they couldn't. And so that was the reason that Monterey, which has this beautiful bay, you'd think they could, you know, make a huge port out of it. That was the reason Monterey had to give up to San Francisco. And so that was another thing that I thought was interesting and that I put into the book.
One thing I found interesting is, you know, we live in modern times and, you know, you're 2 hours from me. But in those days, San Francisco and the East Bay, which was mostly vacant or still trees at that point, mm-hmm. they were really far away. You couldn't just say, hey, I'm going to San Francisco. That was a trip.
Well, that was a trip and it was a big decision for Eliza. One of her young customers comes from the family ranch that's essentially in Carmel Valley, sort of not far from where I live. And when he wants to go into Monterey, it takes him a really long time. He can only do that every once in a while. And it takes me 20 minutes.
The mystery itself, Jane Smiley, the mystery, did you work that out beforehand or did you kind of, as you were writing, kind of it opened itself to you?
I did the second thing. I knew what was going on. I set up the killings and the plot. And then as I did the research into what life is like in Monterey, and as I walked around and drove around the peninsula, then I had to figure out what it was likely to happen. The other thing was that, you know, both Eliza and Jean are total neophytes at this. And so they try things, they want to do things, they want to find out things. But they don't know, they've never done anything like this before. So they have to make a few mistakes or go sometimes in the wrong direction before they can figure out what actually happened.
And as they're doing that, it's coming to you, who was doing the killing and how it's going to turn out, like almost an aha moment at some point?
Well, I had a sense of who was doing the killing fairly early on, maybe say halfway in. But the thing is, when you're writing a mystery, which I have done one time before, you have to be so circumspect about what you think so that the hints don't creep into the narrative so that the reader can see them. So that in some sense is the hardest part of writing a murder mystery is don't give it away.
And you titled the book A Dangerous Business because of a quote, being a woman is a dangerous business. Is that quote just from the book or did you get that from somewhere else?
No, that's just from the book. I really enjoyed exploring the character of Mrs. Parks. Now, here we have Eliza, who's 20, 21 in the book. And here's this woman who runs the brothel. And I imagined her being maybe in her early 40s. And she comes from the East, and she too has spent time as a prostitute. And she is a very organized and understanding woman. And one of the things that she must understand is that the girls that work for her have to be taken care of, and they have to be treated well. Because in Monterey at that time, the proportion of females to males was pretty small. And so if Mrs. Parks wants to have a business that lasts and thrives, she has to take good care of it. And I also think she's a decent person, inherently a decent person. She's from the East, and she is the first one who tells Eliza about a women's voter rights convention that took place in upstate New York around the time that all of this is taking place in California. So I was quite fond of Mrs. Parks, and I think I wanted her to treat the girls well.
There's also a sort of around the edges, the anti-slavery movement, and I won't get into some secrets that are revealed there, but for you as a writer, was it hard to kind of tamp down that and the women's movement so that it just kind of simmers behind the scenes?
One of the things that I liked was that the men that she meets in her job, who some of them are quite old, some of them are quite young, and some of them are, you know, about her age, they're very different from one another, and they have different sets of knowledge, and they have different opinions about what's going on in the country. So that gave me an opportunity to talk about things that she would have talked about with some of these men. But that I would say that was my favorite part, was having her meet all these guys and having her observe them and enjoy some of them and be afraid a little bit of some of them. And that was one of my favorite parts.
And creating these different men themselves, because each one has their own personality that only she can see.
Yes, that's the wonderful thing about writing about a woman who works in a brothel. She gets to see things about men that aren't public.
And you get to play with that.
Yeah. I'm going to give one giveaway a little bit, because one of my favorite ones was when a father brings his teenage son in to be introduced to sex. And the son, Eliza quite likes the son. And the thing the son is most interested in is looking at Eliza, because he wants to be a doctor and he's never actually seen a woman without any clothes on before. And that's what he's interested in.
You must have been laughing while you were writing it.
I was enjoying it for sure.
Jane Smiley, I want to move a little bit from that and ask you a couple of things that I don't think I've asked you about in the past. In 2011, you wrote a book called Charles Dickens, A Life. What was your impetus in writing it, and having written a biography, did that aid you in just learning more about the research, or was it just, I'm going to write about Dickens because I love him?
I think I read online that someone was doing a series of books about people that, literary people, but others too, who were important from the 19th century, who were important in the 20th century. And I contacted that person who was the editor. And I said, I think you should do one about Charles Dickens. And he said, okay, go ahead and do it. And I knew that there had been a lot of, or a number of books about Dickens from his own time and later. But one of the things that interests me about biographies is that lots of times they are about the biographer's opinion of Dickens or of the character that's, or the person that's being written about. And I was more interested, since the book had to be short, in trying to imagine what it felt like to be Charles Dickens, what it felt like to grow up the way he did and to have his success and to write the books and to have his set of, what do you want to call them, idiosyncrasies or eccentricities. And I quite enjoyed it. I read the previous biographies. I walked around London and looked at the places that Dickens would have been. And I read all the books. And it was a lot of fun.
What was it like rereading all of these books after many years?
Well, some of them held up and some of them didn't. It turned out that my favorite wasn't David Copperfield, which had been before. It was now Our Mutual Friend. And that's pretty much still my favorite. I think that's a totally fascinating book. It has the best portrayal of a stalker in the history of literature. I really, really liked it. You know, I liked plenty of the others too. It was fun to reread them.
Jane Smiley, when we started, you said that while you were working on Perestroika in Paris, you were already well on the way to either thinking about or starting the writing of A Dangerous Business, your most recent novel. What are you working on now?
I just turned in my manuscript, corrected draft of a novel called Lucky. And it's because I started to write it because I was in St. Louis in 2017, and I got an interview, and the guy asked me if I'd ever written a book set in St. Louis, and I hadn't. And I thought, that's really weird since I grew up here. So I decided to set a book in St. Louis about a woman who is about my age, but she makes her way in the music business rather than the literature business. And so I just followed her through that.
Is it contemporary?
Yeah.
And any more mysteries that you would have put under a pseudonym?
There is one. It's just sitting around. I wrote it in 2012. I kind of like it. Maybe it'll get out sometime.
Is it finished?
Yeah, it's finished. And I also wrote a sequel to The All True Travels and Adventures of Liddy Newton. And I really like it. But my editor said, I can't look as though I'm obsessed with the 1850s. So we have to wait on that one.
You can't look like you're obsessed with the 1850s, yet somewhere in there we see Charles Dickens. I don't know. I think it's okay to be obsessed with the 1850s. It was a very interesting time.
Well, there's an American historian that I'm acquainted with named David Blight. And he actually said to me, the 1850s were a pivotal decade and were the most pivotal decade in American history. And so I think, yeah, the 1850s, let's go for it.
You've been listening to an interview with Jane Smiley, whose latest novel is A Dangerous Business. I'm Richard Wolinsky on the Bookwaves Artwaves Hour on KPFA. Faye Weldon, who died on January 4, 2023 at the age of 91, published 31 novels during her lifetime, including The Life and Loves of a She-Devil, one of four novels which were later adapted to film. She was also a playwright, short story writer, television writer, and nonfiction author. Among her nonfiction works was a memoir of her early years, Auto da Fé, published in 2000, and among her television work was the very first episode of Upstairs, Downstairs in 1971. Richard A. Lupoff and I interviewed her in the KPFA studios in March 1990 while she was on tour for her now classic novel, The Cloning of Joanna May.
Now, when we were doing our research, I found out you worked in a variety of jobs before you actually became a writer, including you wrote reports for the British Foreign Office on the Polish desk.
That's true, yes. Unqualified, and yes, I did.
And you also worked on the problem page of a newspaper?
I did.
What did you do?
I remember I answered queries on hire purchase, not so much romantic problems or questions of the heart, but just legal matters. Very boring when it comes down to it.
So it wasn't like from there you got some of your ideas for your more outlandish characters?
No. You don't have to look at the newspapers. You just look around your friends.
Now, your mother was a romance author?
Well, she ended up as a romance author. She started out as what we know as a serious author, but she was also trying to keep a family on her, the proceeds of her writing, and so she took to more, to simpler forms.
Now, you also have a romance novelist as, I don't know if you'd call her the antagonist or what, of Life and Loves of a She-Devil. Was that character in any way based on your mother?
Oh, no. Goodness me, no. I never even thought of such a thing. No. My mother is a very intellectual and austere and rational person, and Mary Fisher is the opposite of all these things. It broke my mother's heart to have to write romantic fiction, but, you know, you do all kinds of things if you're going to feed a family.
And you grew up in an all-female household?
I did, yes. A mother, a sister, a grandmother, myself, and me. I went to an all-girls school. And scarcely a man ever crossed the threshold. He must have once, actually.
Did you have any male friends when you were growing up at all?
No, none. Absolutely none, no.
Then it must have been very odd to finally meet them and find out what they're like.
It was quite exciting, yes. It was most remarkable. It really was. Astonishing.
What was your first impression when you discovered this other kind of strange creature walking around?
Well, it took me a long time to realize that they had feelings. They didn't seem to me to be quite real. I still think I have some problem in this area. But I gathered in the end that they were more or less like we were, you know.
I think that's probably universal. Men feel that way about women. Women feel that way about men.
Yes.
A woman named Alice Sheldon, who used to write under the name James Tiptree,
yes,
wrote a story in which she suggested that one gender or the other were alien creatures and not really originated on this earth at all.
Well, I mean, we do struggle not to believe this. We do struggle these days to believe that we're all the same, or really that we have to look at people as persons first and of a certain gender second. And I'm sure I try all the time, but it does go slightly against the grain.
I have a quote of yours here. I used to think men were wicked. Now I think people are wicked. Would you agree with that now?
Yes. Well, you see, I am getting better, aren't I? I'm little by little learning. I don't know. I don't think people are wicked. I think people actually try astonishingly hard to be good, but they do keep failing. At least for the most part, they acknowledge that good exists, and they do try to. They try to be virtuous.
How about Carl May from The Cloning of Joanna May?
Well, he was a pretty bad guy, wasn't he? But I quite like him, really. He just had a rather hard childhood and an unfortunate habit of murdering his wife's lovers. But many a man feels like doing such a thing, and many a court allows him to do it, so far as I can see, with impunity.
Was Carl May based on any real incident, particularly his childhood?
No, I don't think so, except that he was brought up in a kennel, wasn't he?
Yes.
I thought he was a dog. But he had a little patch of sky that he could see, like Oscar Wilde in Reading Jail, and he kind of yearned towards that. So he had his feelings and he had his emotions, and he was rescued from it and given a very good education indeed, and grew up to be a man of great power and influence in the land. I sometimes think many of our leaders are rather like this. I know that a kennel isn't quite a way of describing an English public school, but it's pretty much the same kind of thing.
You have a number of these human monsters in your books. Carl May certainly is perhaps the worst. Ruth from Life and Loves of a She-Devil.
Look, how can you say such a thing? When I go to my supermarket back home in Somerset, England, they all look exactly like Ruth. They really do.
I'm not talking about physically. I'm talking about what she does.
Oh, she did become a monster. She was started off as a very good woman indeed. She was a good wife, good mother, a good housekeeper, a bit clumsy, but it didn't do her any good at all in the world. Her husband said she was a she-devil, so she thought she might as well be one.
And
because obviously
she
being
it.
Good didn't kind of move him at all.
I got the feeling that she-devil, skipping ahead a little, is a kind of Frankenstein story, and Ruth is both her own doctor and the monster itself. She remakes herself and gives herself new life.
She does, and she remakes herself in such a peculiar image, though, doesn't she? She remakes herself in something supremely silly.
Which everyone else notices, except her.
Except her. She doesn't mind. She wants to do it, and she does it. I got into some trouble with that book because I wouldn't say somehow at the end she shouldn't have done this because women are supposed to be content with what they look like no matter what it is and are supposed to tell themselves it's what a woman is, not what she looks like, that counts, you see. But I wouldn't reinforce this rather absurd notion.
Well, it seems that the book takes her, and I guess the movie up to a point, takes her in a direction that you're going, right on, Ruth, right on, and then she crosses the line. I think in the book it's at the moment when she says not only to remake her face, but to cut off a few inches off of her legs.
Yeah, it does sound bizarre, doesn't it, really?
Yeah.
But that's what she wanted to do.
Did you feel that the character got away from you a little bit there?
No, I didn't. That was what she... No, not at all. She was actually suffering not from jealousy, but from envy. And the only way you can really deal with envy is actually to become the envied object. And she became the envied object. She had to go through considerable pain and effort and trouble to do it, but that's what she wanted, and she did. In a way, those women are two halves of one woman. The monster and the angel, there's the good woman and the bad woman. Together they make up one perfectly reasonable human being.
You raise a very interesting point, the difference between jealousy and envy. Would you elaborate on that?
Jealousy is a rational emotion. It is caused by something. You fear that you are going to lose something that is of value to you, and the emotion is something that you can act upon, usually, I suppose, revenge, as it were. They have done something nasty to you. You do something nasty to them. There is some sense of possible action that you can take which relieves the pressure of the emotion somewhat. Envy is something, it's a very disagreeable feeling which you're not allowed or supposed to have, but people do have it, and I do feel that plain women have it about pretty women. And you envy your neighbours what they have, the things that you want that you can't have, and it's very real. And there's almost no way of dealing with it except to own it. But if you are talking of another person, then you become it, and then the feeling is gone.
You raise the issue about wanting to change one's own appearance and the fact that nowadays that is a subject of political controversy. On the one hand, there's the argument that we must learn to accept ourselves as we are, fat or thin, tall or short, smooth complexions or warts and pimples or however. The other side, which is more of our consumerist philosophy, is to everyone should be beautiful and you must go out and spend all your money to get there. Are you taking sides on this?
Well, no, I think I'm just presenting it. I mean, both these things are true, and it is a kind of internal struggle that we all have because, you know, it is really rather unworthy and irreligious and ungrateful to the God who made you to suggest that he could have done it any better. Nevertheless, when we look at it, we can see that perhaps he could have.
Even the character of Ruth at the beginning, now, you know, I don't think she was a monster, I mean, physically at all. In fact, a number of men are attracted to her right through the book.
Yes, but that's because the devil's on her side.
Okay, what are your feelings on God and the devil?
God and the devil. Well, I don't. I mean, I don't know. That they exist, I would grant you. That I don't. Whoever this God is, he didn't make a very good job of things. I do think that man has obviously got a much, by which of course I include women, the lesser.
Right.
I do think a man has a kind of moral sense which God, so far as we can see in his work, simply does not. So I would see man as actually a rather higher form than our creator. I think we've sort of taken a march on him, actually.
Well, if God is not moral and the devil is the opposite of God, what's the difference?
Well, I can't see much, to tell you the truth. I think people used to get burnt for saying this kind of thing. It was a Manichaean heresy or something.
Right.
Well, people still offer million-dollar rewards.
Yes, they do. Yes, they do, for saying such things. It's true.
Your book, Shrapnel Academy, deals with your feelings about war. What I found fascinating is the end of the book, where it's almost the proverbial, well, what happens? Well, everybody walks into a street, a bus hits them, and they're all killed.
Yes, but I let some free, didn't I?
You did let some free.
That was the point, actually, not the ones that went, but the ones that survived. I allowed, actually, one really nice, simple man and one rather foolish feminist out to repopulate the world.
Now, did you intend on just blowing up your book on page 160?
Yes, I did, because this seemed to me it was an exercise about how people blow things up, how they end up blowing things up when they don't mean to. That was the whole point. So, yes, I certainly did.
And, in fact, the analogy with Napoleon is the same thing in the book.
Yes, of course it was. And the whole thing becomes a parable of the Western world and the third or fourth or fifth world, and so forth and so on. And you put them all in a house and you play out the dramas, the end of which can only be, really, if they persist in the idiocy in blowing themselves up.
Without planning to.
Without, of course, planning to. And who blows themselves up planning to? You know, you blow your enemy up and you usually blow yourself up as well.
You also address the reader as gentle reader. Are your readers, or Faye Weldon's readers, gentle?
They're quite nice people. No, my theory is they're just human beings, and so they're not particularly gentle, but it's a convention to call them gentle, in a rather old-fashioned sense of the word, which really actually doesn't mean quite what we know it now, but really people with style and taste enough to appreciate what you're saying.
You speak of the old-fashioned style, and in fact, critics have compared you to such writers as Dickens and Anthony Trollope. Yet, it seems to me that many of your attitudes and imagery is very, very modern, perhaps even what we sometimes call on the cutting edge of being postmodern. Are you living in two centuries or three centuries at once?
I think it's a question of narration and the way you tell stories. I still do a lot of television writing. That's very quite bleak in a way. I mean, you say what you've got to say and you get out as quickly as you can,
yes,
leaving the work to others. The writing of a novel also, it seems, if you are writing for people who actually absorb their fiction through the screen, which most of us do now, then there is a way of dealing with narrative which is the same as film does it. And it's different from... You don't have to use so many words as Dickens. Trollope managed to use not very many words. I mean, the book's quite long, but he doesn't go into long, sort of overwritten passages the way Dickens does.
Dickens was the champion, at least.
Yes, let me not say overwritten.
Today, 1990, most of our bestsellers are these huge, fat, what my partner here, Richard Wolinsky, calls bloat books.
Well, people like to think they've got their money's worth, don't they? Really?
That's my theory. You continue to write more spare books.
Yes, I'm writing. They're getting a bit longer, I notice. The last one's got whole pages without paragraphs or conversation. I've just finished that one. My editor's rather alarmed and keeps putting in paragraphs. Little did we think we'd ever come to this.
I'd like to get back for a second to Cloning of Joanna May. It's sort of science fiction.
Science speculation. Let us not suppose that these things are in the future. I fear they are now.
You're listening to an interview with the late novelist Faye Weldon, who died on January 4th, 2023, at the age of 91, recorded while she was on tour for her novel, The Cloning of Joanna May. My co-host was Richard A. Lupoff, and I'm Richard Wolinsky on the Bookwaves Artwaves Hour.
Do you have a background in science fiction or speculation? Have you read books?
Oh, yes, yes, yes. I used to read astounding science fiction as a child, ceaselessly.
Do you remember any of your favorite stories from that?
Yes, I remember Aliens now. Okay, Alien came from a science fiction story. I was rather shocked when I thought that somebody's cheated, somebody's remembered this story. Yes, lots of them. Yes. I remember them. Wonderful one about life on top of a table. Now, who was that? That was...
might have been either Heinlein or a Blish story.
No, not a Pole, but it was Frederick
Pole. Frederick Pole?
That was Fred Pole. And the only time I've ever been moved to want to make a film about anything was that particular story. It was about a market research operation, but again, it started with an explosion. The whole town had been wiped out. He suddenly began to realize he was living the same day over and over again, but the slogans were different, and it was wonderful.
I don't remember the story. Sounds almost like a Phil Dick story, but if it was...
Oh, no, yeah. It wasn't.
But are you familiar with his works?
Oh, yes, 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 yes. I'm his fan. I think Pynchon, you see, is actually... The latest Pynchon is actually written by Philip K. Dick, reincarnated.
Well, numerous books have come out that read as if they were written by Philip K. Dick, reincarnated. Is he pretty much your favorite science fiction writer?
Yes, I think so. If I'm sort of, but then Huxley wrote Brave New World.
I also notice in some of your attributions where you can cite authors whom you liked, to me intriguing list of George Bernard Shaw, Sinclair Lewis, and of course H.G. Wells, who was the father of modern science fiction.
Yes, yes.
Are you well informed on matters of technology?
Yes, yeah, I reckon so, more or less.
How do you do that?
I just read magazines. I read New Scientist every week, which becomes a kind of soap opera, really. You know, it's just popular science.
I noticed that, obviously the cloning of Joanna May, the title itself is indicative of one theme, but there are also the whole Chernobyl incident, which I think may become some sort of paradigm for its era, just as Hiroshima... Yes. Was a paradigm of 40 years earlier. It pervades the book.
Yes, it's there really because that was the unexpected and extraordinary thing that made us, especially in Europe, realize that it wasn't science fiction, that it did happen, and that it was here. And it's there as a background to this book because though that, the contents of this book, which is the whole matter of genetic engineering, sounds as if it's in the future, it is actually happening now, and it's very hard for people to understand, to make this jump in their own mind into a world which is going on as it used to, or did in their parents' generation. It's actually beginning, little by little, to happen now, as you see it in the various legal tussles over who owns the sperm or the egg or so forth and so on. And the whole sense of, I think the most profound sense that it's, the difference that it's making, is making children seem less and less to belong to the mother or the father, because you can see that the baby grows in, or simply uses a womb to grow in, and that it's not a magic part of the baby, that it grew in this, or for the mother, that the baby grew in this particular place. So the whole notion of motherhood, I think, has taken a great knock, whether it's good or bad. But these things happen almost without us even realizing it or thinking about it.
Well, cloning removes men completely. If it's a woman being cloned, as in this book, it removes men completely from the equation.
Well,
entirely.
Men, but on the whole, men are doing it. I mean, it takes it out of the hands of women. You can clone men without bothering about. You still need a womb, but you suspect that the surrogate, as we had right back in Huxley's book, will do the same thing.
Start with the premise, for example, of let's suppose you were a clone of Joanna May.
Yes.
And you're implanted in a woman and you grew up in an all-women's household.
Yes.
And then you see your first man. Mm. It is an alien species. It's got no connection with you except through some kind of multi-generational thing in the past, like yes. dinosaurs.
Yes. Except, you know, I mean, they did have their attractions, men. Let us not suppose that they didn't when you meet them. The shock of the new and so forth. I have four sons, you know, now,
right.
and a husband. And I mean, I just moved from all female to all male.
If you don't mind reverting for a moment to a little bit of family history, I was really quite astonished to realize that you are descended from the literary Jepson family of Selwyn Jepson, Edgar Jepson, your mother Margaret Jepson, who was also Pearl Bellairs. You grew up then, or did you grow up, surrounded by literature and a lot of literary stimulus?
Well, I grew up in New Zealand because my mother married my father when she was very young. My father was an English doctor. We went out to New Zealand. The war came. There was very little connection except what that I sort of read the book and knew about them all, and they were, and my mother's family was part of the H.G. Wells Shaw literary, and the Fabians and all that particular literary set. So I was brought up, as it were, with stories of that. But then by the time we came back after the war, my grandfather had died. My uncle and my mother quarrelled over something. And so there was very little yes. connection in that, you know, very little literary connection. My mother had stopped writing by then. So when I started, I was working in an advertising agency and I just, as it were, started fresh. All that tradition was stopped with the war. It was a kind of convulsion in cultural affairs, really. I think that we all suffered there.
You've written a great many books, short stories, you've written for theater, I believe, for television. Is there a purpose to all of this fiction other than, let me preface this, it's obvious that the author makes a living out of it and the reader gets some enjoyment out of it. If that's the whole transaction, I suppose that is sufficient. But I wonder if there is more to it than that.
Oh, yes, I want to change the world. Yes, I want to change the world. I think people live within myths. They live within myths of what they are. They live within myths of what their society is and what it's trying to do. And up to a point, that's quite good, or at least sustains them through fairly difficult lives. But then it comes a point when the myth actually begins to damage. And I think it's in those areas that I like to work. There's a kind of, you get a whole consensus of ideas, and you get it both on the left and you get it on the right, and it gets out of control. So the consensus of opinion on the left now is beginning to be damaging to itself, I think. I mean, things change all the time, mm-hmm. and you have to keep this pendulum swinging. So.
And in view of the really monstrously or gigantically dramatic events of the past year. We are speaking in the end of March 1990, and
yes.
I think the past 12 months have had more history in them than the past 40 years.
Yes. Ideas change. Ideas move people. They get into people's head. Truth. People have great hunger for truth. They have a hunger for freedom, but they don't have any food for it, or not much. You can live in a very free society and still not have any ideas coming through to you. Once the ideas are there, if they're in your interests, you absorb them. You change. People get better. I do really believe this. They develop empathy. I think fiction is extraordinarily important in this process. It's the only way we know what it is to be another person. Once you know and feel and understand that, it's extremely difficult to damage them. I mean, I find it more and more difficult to go outside my front door and eat my sheep.
You've been listening to a March 1990 interview with the late novelist and playwright Faye Weldon, who died on January 4th, 2023, at the age of 91. My co-host was Richard A. Lupoff. Faye Weldon's career continued for the next 30 years with several more novels, including a sequel to She-Devil, more plays, more short stories, and several works of nonfiction. Dick Lupoff and I had a second chance to interview Faye Weldon 2 years later while she was on tour for her novel, Life Force. That interview will air later this year. I'm Richard Wolinsky on the Bookwaves Artwaves Hour. Coming up now, the weekly Bookwaves Artwaves Theater Review. We hear a lot about incarceration in the United States. What we hear less about is what happens when people come out of the prison system. While employers are not supposed to ask about previous arrests and convictions, that information usually rears its ugly head. This means that most ex-cons must take whatever they can get, even if it means a job they know nothing about and a boss from hell. In Clyde's, a comedy by Lynn Nottage, now at Berkeley Rep through February 26th, we meet a handful of these ex-cons. Clyde's is a truck stop specializing in sandwiches and run by Clyde herself, a hard-nosed woman with, as she calls them, investors who are only interested in the bottom line. Working the kitchen are three ex-cons, a young black woman, Letitia, a young Latino man, Raphael, and an older black man, Montrellis, who knows his way around the kitchen. We learn early on exactly who Clyde is. She threatens, she sexually harasses, she screams, she demeans, she throws fits, and all her employees must take it, or she can send them right back to the hoosegow. Enter then a young man, Jason, with supremacist tattoos all over his body and face. We expect sparks to fly, only they don't, because this is a comedy, and often a very funny one. The young man is ashamed of the markings as well as his temper that put him in prison in the first place. From here on out, it's going to be Kitchen versus Clyde, with side trips along the way about their private lives and about sandwiches, food. Montrellis is played by Harold Surratt with a mixture of joy and forbearance. He's the Buddha of the sandwich, with Letitia, Raffi, and later Jason, his acolytes. And then there's their antagonist, Clyde, in a necessarily over-the-top performance by April Nixon, treating the play like a trucker devouring a hoagie. And she's ably assisted by a cascade of wigs and eye-popping outfits by Karen Perry and Megan Ellis. And attention should also be paid to the kitchen itself, a marvel of scenic design by Wilson Chin. And then there's Lynn Nottage's smart, savvy, and often mouth-watering dialogue. The four ex-cons are, in their own way, chefs struggling to survive under difficult circumstances, whether attempting to create the perfect sandwich, fighting off Clyde's often despicable behavior, or even getting emotionally involved with each other. These are people who are fun to be around, and with the best of plays and the best of company, we really don't want to say goodbye. Clyde's by Lynn Nottage plays at Berkeley Rep's Pete's Theater through February 26th. For more information, you can go to berkeleyrep.org. Until next week, I'm Richard Wolinsky on the Bookwaves Artwaves Hour.
Welcome to On the Deck. My name is Miko Tolliver. I'm here with our interim general manager, Antonio Ortiz.
Yes, Sunday from 11 a.m. to 6 p.m., we had the Black History Month special. Well, we had one lead producer, Prema Jackson, associate producer, Rashida Chase, and our technical producer, Rod Akil, working on that, coordinating with a bunch of other producers at KPFA and outside of KPFA to bring you content for Black History Month.
Somebody's at the door. It's Prema Jackson, lead producer of the Black History Month special broadcast.
The show itself, we finally decided on Past Light, Clear Sight. What is using everything we have to move forward into who we are and who we can be.
Thank you, Prema.
Yeah, all right, folks. So that was Prema Jackson, our amazing, amazing guest. We'll let her leave now. Oh, bye, Prema. We want to encourage everybody again to go to Area 941 Podcast, KPFA.org.
Howard Zinn.
Orwell said that whoever controls the past controls the future.
And whoever controls the present controls the past. So whoever is in charge of our society can decide what our history will look like. And by deciding what our history will look like, they will decide our future. Well, that made history very important to me because it meant that history was not disengaged from society, that to create a more democratic history meant that you were at least playing some part in trying to create a more democratic society.
Storytelling for social change on KPFA.
You're listening to 94.1 KPFA, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, and online worldwide at kpfa.com.